Welcome to today's meeting of Democrats of Greater Tucson. This is Larry Bodine, and I'm the president of Democrats of Greater Tucson, and I want to give you all a warm Democratic welcome for being here today. Our speaker is Catalina Hall from LD11. Give us a wave, Catalina.
Hello, and I just want to say, first off, thank you for having me. I really appreciate that you did.
We have a couple of housekeeping announcements. Our first announcement is from Kathy Ramage White, our membership director. Kathy, tell us about joining DGT.
Hey there, everybody. Several of you have been to multiple meetings, so you're used to hearing from me. I hope, however, that you're not so used to it that you just block me out and forget to go ahead and sign up. It's only going to cost you $20, and it's real easy to sign up for DGT. When you come into the DGT website, you can sign right up. It'll take care of everything through Act Blue. Remember, everybody, and Catalina too, get yourself signed up for DGT. So now, Sandy, I'll send this off to you.
Next week, we have Margot Haven, who is a public defender and is the person who is kind of the starter of this Justice for All initiative to give legal representation to people coming up before INS because they haven't always had legal representation. And so there's this group that's trying to get an initiative going, and she's going to be speaking to us next week. Okay. Then we have Mario Yasmel, who is the director of the Pima County Housing Center, and he will be telling us about all the different kinds of housing things available and how to access that. And this is, of course, everything from public housing to subsidized housing to a whole bunch of other things. And then the last Monday this month is Steve Kovacek, councilman from Ward 6, and who is running in Ward 6. That's what's coming up in the future, and we've got some other exciting speakers coming up the month after that, and I'm working on the month after that. So please join us.
Thanks again for all your hard work. I know these speakers are tough to nail down. So we appreciate it, Sandy. Shirley Muni has her hand up. Go ahead, Shirley.
Thanks. Hi. I want to remind you the webinar for Great Decisions, Tucson Great Decisions Association, is coming up in 2 weeks. It's called Will the Pandemic Kill Off Right-Wing Populism in Western Europe? And apparently just about every country in Europe has a right-wing populist organization, if not in charge of the country, trying to be. This is at 2 p.m. on Monday, the 19th. That's 2 weeks from today. Register by mail or online with a credit card. It's www.tgda, stands for Tucson Great Decisions Association, tgda.org. It does cost $10. We have to give our speakers an honorarium. You're all welcome. It's open to the public. Thank you.
Turning to you now, Susie Anderson. I understand you have an announcement.
It's something that we're going to all have to try to do, if you please. A plethora of dangerous bills will be sent to Governor Ducey in the coming days and weeks, and we're calling on members of DGT to urge him to veto them, which is probably unlikely, but if we don't do something, nothing will happen. So we're offering postcards and stamps so you and your friends can write to Ducey to veto some of these bills. Now, there are so many of them, you probably need to send several postcards. We've got Senate Bill 1273, which expands school vouchers for private schools. 2 years ago, that initiative was upheld by the Arizona Supreme Court that said no vouchers. And the Senate, of course, in their great lack of wisdom, decided to go ahead and get more school vouchers. 1783 trims Proposition 208 revenues by a half or third. Okay, the people spoke on that, but apparently the Senate didn't hear. House Bill 2140 criminalizes providing an abortion, makes it a felony, and sends doctors or healthcare providers to jail. Oh, and here's the Corporation Commission on HB 2248 from setting clean energy standards. Okay, why do we have a Corporation Commission when we know what a fantastic job the Senate would do with that? Senate Bill 1452, the voucher expansion bill, another one. 1041 and 1118 are STO vouchers. They expand those, putting much higher caps on them. Then there's another list, 1485. These are the voting bills. So if you didn't vote in every election, you're taken off the pebble list. 1713, and they're still figuring out how to do this, because if you write your voter ID number on the outside, security flies out the window. 1010 expands the hand count threshold to at least 5%. 1793 regarding the transmission of death records and ballot fraud measures. And we know how fraudulent last year's election was. And then the recorder bill to vilify recorders for mailing out ballots that were unasked for, and 2569. If you all want postcards, information on these lists of bills, contact Larry or myself. We would love to inundate Mr. Ducey with postcards, especially those with our logo on it. Thank you.
If you need postcards, we've got them, stamps too. Best to send one postcard for every issue that you're writing about. So if you get five cards, you can write about five bills, or you can write about one bill and give the other four cards to your friends, whatever works for you. Let's get on with our speaker today. Introduce you all to Catalina Hall. She is the chair of the LD11 Democrats, and she's been a Democrat ever since the resignation of Richard Nixon. Born and raised in Detroit, Michigan, she attended school at the Eastern Michigan University. She and her husband moved to Tucson 22 years ago, and she is coming to us live today from way out west in Picture Rocks. In Michigan, Catalina ran for state representative twice. She was continually active in the ACLU, the National Organization of Women, the Unitarian Universalist Church, and all of her kids' parent-teacher organizations. Catalina was the longtime secretary of LD25 from 2003 to 2012. And then she became the secretary in her current legislative district, number 11, followed by being second vice chair, first vice chair, and now the chair. So Catalina, the floor is yours.
Thank you so much. Really do appreciate everyone today coming out to hear me, and thank you so much for having me. I feel honored. Now, as I was telling Lee earlier, LD11 stretches from outside the city limits of Tucson. The best we could do are a couple of precincts in the Amphi School District. We go all the way north along I-10 to Maricopa City, which is outside of Phoenix itself, but still in Maricopa, sort of straddles Maricopa County. So we encompass Pima and Pinal counties. We also are really lucky to have eight clubs. We go by the club model out here because we are so stretched out. We are so vast. It is a bit of a trip to go from one end to the other. And I just got to give a shout out to those great Democratic clubs. And in alpha order, they are the Copa City Democrats, the Democrats of Casa Grande, the Democrats of Oro Valley, the Democrats for Picture Rocks, Highlands Dove Mountain Democrats, Marana Dems and Friends, Saddlebrooke Dems Democrats, and Sun City Democrats. I don't know what I would do without them. So LD11, once you leave the city limits of Tucson, we are outnumbered out here. We are outnumbered in most of the precincts in LD11. There are a few precincts near Casa Grande that we are neck and neck, and that's great. Thanks to Ralph Atchew for that. But basically, we're outnumbered, and we have to take that into account. And so what we're working on right now is growing as much as we can during the pandemic. We really can't go door to door. I don't ask anyone to do that. I don't think it's a good idea right now, but I leave it up to people. And we are looking to grow. We are looking to look at those left-leaning independents who may come over. And we're looking at people who are not registered at all, which are even harder to find, right? You know all this stuff. But we're working on it, and we're going to continue to work on it, even though the redistricting is like hangs over our heads. Because if we're redistricted and again, still not competitive, we will have much more work to do. And of course, we all have to reorganize after the redistricting is done. I just hope that we get a more competitive map in Arizona. And to that end, we have several people who keep track of the redistricting meetings and the any of information coming from them or going to them. And right now, they're still in the process of getting organized. We don't expect that they'll get the final numbers for the census until probably August. It goes back and forth. We see it later than that. We see it earlier than that. Once that happens, it's going to be very complicated. And right now, unfortunately, the so-called independent, who is the elected chair, seems to have some Republican ties that we objected to. It didn't do anything. He's still the chair. But we are keeping up with them. And, you know, you can go and get this information. You can be on the redistricting site. The easiest way I found it was to go to meetings in Arizona state government. Go to the meetings and you can draw it up there, okay? But yeah, everybody, let's keep track of that. Wonder if they go right down the middle of Tucson and divide you up, because like I said, outside the city limits, Democrats are outnumbered, and that will no longer be a competitive district. And that's very concerning. It could happen. I doubt if it will, but it could happen. One thing that our LD11 is trying to do is work with the rural council that is a part of the state Democratic committee. And the rural council is trying to, within each county party, so for example, it'd be Pima County Democrats, would be able to hire a person that could organize the rural parts of the county. Because not so far away from you, like right here in Picture Rocks, which is all the west side of the Tucson Mountains, we're rural. We're not in any city. The only political designation we have is the Picture Rocks Fire Department. We don't have a elected body, and we don't show on most maps. You will get picture rocks on some maps, you won't on others. And we are rural, so we are looking to help the rural council. And you can help too, because there'll be lots of things we can do, especially if we have this hired person that will see to the organization. Now, I also heard that y'all are interested in hearing about our recall of MF. Now, I'm from Detroit, and that's city slang for somebody you used to love but can no longer trust. Think about it. So MF, which I think describes him perfectly. Did everybody get that? No? Okay. Oh, okay. No, you didn't? Think about it. Okay, somebody did. All right. So MF, the group, and they're here today, the rural Arizonans, took up the torch and are organizing the collection of signatures. Now, you have to be an LD11 to sign, but that doesn't keep you as volunteers within LD11. So if you go on recallfincham.com, it's very easy, recallfincham.com, you can volunteer. And what all of our 8 clubs are doing is they're volunteering by taking petitions and standing out, mostly right now in front of the libraries, because the libraries are beginning to open up. And they're standing out there getting signatures. And it's difficult. It really is. You don't have to be a Democrat to sign. You just have to be a registered voter. So you could be any party. And it's really funny to me when I haven't had a chance to do it yet. That's a long story I won't bore you with, but it has to do with grandchildren. I used to get signatures from people who didn't, I would explain what it was, they say they're opposed, and then they sign. You know, it's kind of fun in a way, but it's kind of concerning in another, because I certainly wouldn't sign anything that I disagreed with, but you get people like that all the time. So it can be fun. It also is a time for you to, with COVID rules in mind, be with other Democrats. So go on to their website. The clock is ticking. And because rural Arizona is here, I'll let them tell you in a minute how many signatures or how many petitions they've collected so far. We need over 25,000 signatures. So any help you can give by volunteering, that would be great. Yeah, I know, that's a lot. That's an awful lot. Okay, let's see. We're outnumbered, but we have had some changes made. I want to tell you a little story. During the election, we would, Democrats are picture rocks. And because I'm from there, I'm going to tout them. We'd stand out on Sundario, which is the major north-south street, with signs for Biden and Kelly and any other Democratic candidate. And this was after the primary. And we would stand out there and we'd either get a thumbs up or another digit of the hand. And it was pretty sparse, but a couple days before the election, we had a big group of people that stood out on the corner. We called it the corner. It's the intersection of Picture Rocks and Sundario. And there were quite a few of us. There was like 8 of us, which is a lot. Now in Picture Rocks, a little more than a third of the populace is Republican. A little bit more than a third is independent, and then there's us Democrats. And we tried to keep track. We got a lot of thumbs ups and a lot of thumbs down, or like I said, the other digit in your hand. And it was about 50-50, which is surprising, very surprising when we are the minority. So, I mean, we have to keep looking for these very, very specific reasons to be here, because we are the correct party, and I'm not going to preach to the choir. I did say that I became a Democrat when Nixon resigned. Up until then, I was a Republican. My parents were Republican. Right now, all my family is Republican, which is why they don't speak to me. And which is fine. I keep the lines of communication open. You know, they can get a hold of me. I haven't changed my phone number or anything. And they were the type of Republican that I call the classic Republican. And after Nixon, I could no longer deal with it. But they were classic Republicans, meaning that government did stay out of your private business, and government existed to level a playing field among people with power and people with very little power. And that was the Republican Party in the 50s and 60s about, but not after Nixon was elected. Let's see. Well, I talk very fast. And yeah, my husband's going, yeah, she talks very fast. But what else would you like to know about LD11 and what we see for the future?
All right. Thank you very much, Catalina. I invite everybody to ask questions. You can type it in the chat, but what we would prefer is that you click on the reactions button at the bottom. It's got a little smiley face on it, and raise your hand, and we'll put you on live with Catalina Hall. Catalina, I had a question for you. Since I live closer to central Tucson, how are rural voters different than voters in an urban area? How do you reach them?
It is darn difficult. I see that Brian Johnson is here, and most of you know he ran for county assessor. And one point, we tried to go door to door in Picture Rocks. It's not impossible, but it's damn difficult. And in an hour and a half, we found 5 addresses. What makes it difficult is that most of the people out here are either they're here because they don't want to be near government. There is a general distrust. We also have tried for many years, all of our groups, all of our clubs have tried to reach out to those rural areas. And now with the state Democratic Party putting some money behind it, getting some rural advisors that will get on the ground, we hope to be able to reach them. There are certain places where they do hang out. Like for one, I know they're constantly at the few businesses that we do have in the area. But like they don't really want to be bothered. We did have, now what is helpful is postcards or mailings. And we took it in LD11, we did a massive mailing to voters that were outside and in the rural areas to urge them to vote for Biden and the Democratic ticket. Our good friend, Tom McConnell, who is now in 9, you lucky people, puts together for us how how that plays out, whether or not that reaches people. And 2 years ago, with the midterm election, we also did a mailing project, and generally he found that it did help. Now, actually though, as you all know, the best way to meet people is to knock on their door. That's kind of hard in the rural areas, especially with fences and dogs. And Also, a lot of places don't have their address. A lot of homes don't have their address displayed like they should, which is a crime, because if there's a fire, the fire department can't find you. But we keep trying. And even though we keep trying to knock on doors, we'll keep trying to mail, and we'll keep trying to have events that are generally well attended when we do a mailing for it.
All right, if anybody has a question, just type it in the chat or click the reactions button to raise your hand. We have a question from Jeannie Christie. Go right ahead.
Hi, I really don't have a question. I just wanted to add a little bit about what you're saying about LD11. I am in LD9. However, I worked for Joanna Mendoza in the last election, and I phone banked for her. And I was truly surprised, number one, at how large LD11 is and what it encompasses. Unless you really work it, you really have no idea how disjointed and how odd that LD is. But what I wanted to say is I found that the independents in LD11 were the most hostile. I mean, I got cussed out with words I haven't heard since junior high in Philadelphia. And the Republicans, you know, they seemed unfazed by who was at the top of their ballot. They were more concerned about what went underneath the top of the ballot and or down ballot. And when I talked to them, they would just say, I'm a Republican. I vote Republican. So all these people that you see that people think voted for Trump, in my experience, I found that Republicans vote Republican. It doesn't matter who the president, they're looking at down ballot. And they're very strategic. So I don't know. I don't have a question. I just wanted to add my comment. And thanks for being here.
Oh, no, that's really good. That's a very good observation. Because, again, we're outnumbered. We have to take that into consideration with everything that we do. And we have in the last 8-9 years that we've been LD11. But it doesn't stop us. And like I tell, and like I tell other people, yeah, we may be outnumbered, but we have more fun, we have meetings, and we do stuff.
All right. Jackie Romer has a question. Go ahead, Jackie.
Thank you. Some time ago, we had a speaker who knew a lot about Arizona history and said that ranchers were much more Democrat than you would think in their and how they thought. So my question is, are these people ranchers? Because I'm not familiar with 11. Are they ranchers? And if they're not, what do they want? I think, are they survivalists? Is it kind of that kind? Is it an enclave type situation? Thank you.
Oh, really? I don't know what the breakdown is, I'll be honest. I do know that there is a lot of agriculture out here. They grow a lot of cotton. They grow a lot of soybean. As to actually ranching cattle or other animals, I don't know. And I don't believe there's a lot of them, but I don't know. My own experience is that they are in that group of independents that just wants to be left alone. And can be very, they can be hostile. I've also found the most hostile group, though, are the ones that aren't registered at all and want to fight with you. And I'm nonviolent. I don't fight with them, although, you know, I can defend myself. Yeah, and I'm only 5 foot tall, but I can defend myself. And the ones that are not registered at all, I'm kind of glad they're not. But yes, the most of our population is more into farming than ranching. And thank you. I will look that up.
All right. Let me turn to Lillian Fox, go right ahead.
Hi, I was curious about Fincham. I met him years ago, and it's fair to just say he's a hater. That's what he is. He's just full of hatred and anger. And I wondered who votes for him? What are the issues that keep getting him reelected? And are issues related to federal lands part of it or not at all?
Well, the Republicans in this district, as Jeannie is it, indicated, will just vote straight Republican. They aren't looking at issues there so much as just keeping their majority in the Arizona House and the Arizona Senate. And they're also looking to retain the governorship. What issues move them? The only issue that I see that has most of their interest is the fact that they felt the election was stolen. And that's why when Fincham went to DC in January 6th, I'm sure you all know about it, which caused us all to want to recall him, he was given quite a bit of support from a lot of the people in a lot of the voters in LD11 because he was supporting the president. But as to other issues, there is one other issue that a lot of them, and this goes across all of the polls that I've seen. The one big issue for a lot of people is abortion, that Trump was opposed to abortion, wanted to make it illegal. And he, I don't know if you noticed or not, but when Trump was first being interviewed, he said that for abortions, the women should be put in jail. He didn't get the memo from Right to Life to say, no, we don't ever say that. The women shouldn't go to jail, just the doctors go to jail. So then he recanted that and said, oh yeah, the women shouldn't go to jail. But no, that's how he feels. And the people love that. There's a lot of people who love that. And it impels them to vote.
Okay, next up is John Yoakum. Go ahead, John.
Catalina and I know each other from way back when, but I just wanted to agree with what she just said. It doesn't have anything to do with issues. I don't have a question either. It's not about issues for those people that are voting. It's about party. You could look at the poll numbers and after the two top things on the ballot, Mark Kelly and Joseph Biden, everything else, Republican, 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 right down the line. They didn't have anything to do with who they were. The LD11 candidates that put up by the Democrats were outstanding. They were terrific candidates, and they got creamed because it doesn't have to do with party. They couldn't vote for him because they were listed as Democrats. They had to vote Republican. And like Catalina just said, Mark, whatever his name is an insurrectionist. That's what he is, bottom line. And for him to be, he does feel the heat. He is feeling the heat. That's why he's listed for a different office now. He's filed for Secretary of State. Is that funny or what? That an insurrectionist could run the state election system. Well, he's an anarchist. He wants to take apart the election system. That's what he wants. So, but fine, let him run for a statewide office where he will then lose. And the recall effort is forcing him to think about other options. So I could keep going for another couple hours, but I'll stop my rant.
John?
Yes.
You're not ranting. You're just saying what all of us agree with. And John, I also just want to say personally that I think about Claudia almost every day. I have one of her plants on my kitchen window.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
I don't think it's ranting, but yes, I try not to bore me personally, because I could get into it. I try not to bore the choir. We all right. know what he is.
That's
and
right.
thankfully, we all know what he is. And thankfully, we're, you know, again, as I said, you can volunteer at recallfincham.com. And you can come out here and help out. But you won't be way out west. You can go to one of the Oro Valley Library and the Marana Library. That's where most people are setting up to try and get signatures. And let me just say that they, at first, we were told they weren't going to be that difficult with the signatures on the petitions themselves. But now we found out that you have to be very careful. They have to stay within the lines. They have to not reverse their city designation and their zip code. It has to be exactly right. They can't use ditto marks. Never could. But some people still think they can. It's going to be very touchy, and that's one of the other reasons. The voter suppression bills. That now I forgot who was talking about them earlier. Oh gosh, sorry about that. The voter suppression bills are really another way that they have of keeping us from doing our due diligence. And for the longest time, the state was a model to other states of voting methods that were open and honest. You know, in Michigan, if you want to vote absentee ballot, you have to have a good reason. Here in Arizona, you just ask for it. That's it. But now, oh no, they're seeing that they have to close that up. It's disgusting.
Catalina, I was reading the LD11 newsletter. And I saw that before the elections, you were working with Field Team 6, and you did such a great job. LD 11 was included in the award show from Field Team 6. Tell us about what you did.
Now, that wasn't me, but, you know, I supported them, and we did everything we could to get their message out and be supportive. But our corresponding secretary, Aaron Essef, was cited by them and given an award for being so active in their organization. And that was really nice to see, because as you all are aware, you don't have just Democratic clubs that you belong to. You belong to at least one other, and usually two or three other progressive groups. And what we do is what they, you know, you've heard the terms that everything is connected, an interconnectedness of our groups, and they all have basic beliefs, just like Field Team 6 did and LD11 Democrats do. And yeah, that was really neat. But another one of our members, we have a Susan Anderson also, who is the first vice chair, and she was very active. So yeah, our members, we give a lot of time. All of us give a lot of time.
That's awesome. Evelyn Lathar mentioned in the chat that over the last three elections, Democrats and LD9 have made progress, getting 40%, then 44%, and then 46% of the total vote. And in fact, Precinct 145 and LD11 did turn blue. Do you see the day when LD11 does go Democrat? Is it just a matter of
time? Well, I try to be optimistic, and I think that that's great. And thanks, Evelyn, for posting that. Yes, there's been gains made, but with the redistricting coming up, I'm not so sure. Let's say we are not going to be redistricted. Let's say it doesn't happen. Let's say we keep our district. Yes, but it will mean a lot of work. It will mean a lot of time. And we've got to get out of this COVID, because the best way to sway voters is at their front door. So we will keep working. We're going to remain optimistic, but optimistic with, you know, with caution, because, you know, I can't be all butterflies and happiness and rainbows. That you know, is not tenable. But for everything else, yeah, we got to keep trying.
Another follow-up question. One of the other reprehensible representatives from LD11 is Vince Leach. Do you see him declining in popularity? You think there's a possibility we might be able to get rid of Vince Leach?
Well, no. I, at this point, I don't. Number one, again, we're outnumbered. Number two, we have to have a strong candidate to run against him. Yes, 2022 for everyone, for every district in Arizona. And I doubt if we'll have our new maps by 2022. The way it's looking, but I could be wrong. I could be really wrong. But I would love to get rid of him. We all would, but we have a lot of work to do to get that. One other thing I forgot to say about MF is that in his office, we've had people that went to visit him in his office early in his career. He kept a map on the wall that showed where the Al-Qaeda training camps were in Mexico. And according to this map, he had one right across the border, about 50 miles south of Nogales. And of course, he showed this to everybody and talked about it to everyone. The guy's not only an anarchist and an insurrectionist and an idiot, he's also paranoid. You know, yeah. Al-Qaeda is training people in the desert of the Sonoran Desert in Mexico.
Hard to believe. Hard to believe anybody.
Oh, we got two more questions. Yeah.
All right, we have a question from Lynn Hudson. Go ahead, Lynn.
Thanks. It seems to me that the results, 40 to 44 to 46% of the vote, are very encouraging. And if you are not already doing so, I would advertise that when you're recruiting people to send out petitions, because the general view, and you've shared that with us, is pretty pessimistic about Democrats winning, but a consistent record of progress and getting up to 46% might encourage more people to help you with your petitions. And now I'm going to display my ignorance. I think libraries are a great idea, but are we allowed to go to malls and grocery stores and places like that, Larry, to get people to sign petitions? Because I'm trying to think of the audience out there. And everybody has to eat, but not everybody reads books.
Catalina, what do you know about that? What's involved in being able to stand out in front of a grocery store and have petitions to sign?
You know, I stick to the rules that say that wherever there is a public place, you're allowed. So publicly, now grocery stores are actually on private property. Walmart's on private property. But the easement is public property. And as long as you can keep to the easement of some places, there are locations where you don't have to ask anybody's permission. And if they try to stop you, we've done this before ourselves. You say, sir or ma'am, we're on the public easement. We're exercising our First Amendment rights. You know, there's a lot of amendments in the Constitution. Most people only know the Second Amendment. We're exercising our First Amendment rights, and we have a right to be here. We're not impeding traffic. We're not impeding foot traffic. We're going to stay here and do what we can. But if it's private property, it's a little bit more dicey. Now, I have done it on private property, but if I've been asked to move, I've moved. Because, that's a long story, why I do it that way. I would urge you to be careful. I would urge careful of where you are. I'm not paranoid. The whole time that I've done this, my whole life, I've given out my home phone number. And you know, I haven't gotten one crank call. What's up with that? Don't they know who I am? Don't they care about me? I don't know. But at any rate, but be aware of where you are, your surroundings. You could try it. There are areas where it's not too far away from the doorways into the businesses themselves, but are still on public property. And if you find a place you like, let me know, okay?
All right. Now we have a question from Lillian Fox. Go right ahead, Lillian.
Yeah, I've got two things. I've collected signatures a lot of times in the distant past, and here the Pima Community College campuses are good places to collect signatures. You have to go in and tell them what you're doing, and they will tell you where you can collect signatures, but that's another place that is, some of the campuses are great places to get signatures. I just have kind of a weird question. I was so excited when I was watching election results because for a long time it looked like Fincham was losing. In fact, he was losing, and at the end he won anyway. And so my question is, were the early votes the mail-in votes, or what were they? Because they were overwhelmingly for his opponent, but then he pulled it out and won in the end. Do you happen to know, or not really?
Worked for a time as a election worker for the county. So I was a paid worker, and we would take in the walk-in votes, but they would be counted last. As soon as 7 o'clock came, they would open up. They already had them processed, but they hadn't had them counted. There's a difference, right? You probably know this. I'm sorry. I don't mean to go over stuff you know. But they processed them, and as soon as 7 o'clock, the closing of the polls, they would open those and count them first, run them through 1,000 machines, get the count. And then they would count the walk-in votes. And, you're absolutely right, Lillian. It was just as you say.
So it was the mail-in votes that were overwhelmingly for him or against him? Okay.
All right, we've got a question from Paul Stapleton Smith. Paul, go right ahead.
Thank you, and Catalina, thank you. It's good to see you again. And I look forward to seeing you again very soon. My question is that LD11, of course, as everybody on this call knows, for our statewide, you all did great innovation and are helping us hold the line on statewide, even though we didn't win our ledge races, right? Although we did get our sister Kat Ripley elected to Pima Community College Board, right? It's part of that Arizona ground game. So you're already innovating by working, you mentioned earlier, Field Team 6, Arizona ground game, as I say. We also have Lucha MFV now. They're taking a new look. Prospectively, do you feel that with the way LD11 is reorganizing. I know Evelyn's here. She's, you know, stunning, a strategist as well. Are you going to see LD11's increases with new groups that are coming in, and or a reconfiguration of groups other than our Dem clubs? I guess that's really my question. Will, what is your thoughts on that as a as an organizer?
We want to elect Democrats, and any help we can get to elect Democrats is what we're about. In fact, most of our clubs, their constitution and their statement of purpose is simple, to elect Democrats. Now, if allied groups, and we, like I said earlier, we belong to a lot of allied groups, progressive, left-leaning, left side, whatever. If they also want to elect Democrats, then we can work together. Sometimes, though, it's a little bit it's a little bit sad because there's so much overlap that it doesn't really add to the numbers in that sense of people working. But no, we I really think that we need to hear from all these groups, and I try to get them to talk to us and to keep that conversation going and finding out what they want to do and letting them know what we are about. If I will be honest, that if their first goal is not to elect Democrats, then it's kind of hard to work with them.
Thanks, Catalina. We are out of questions and out of time as well. Wondering if you could wrap up the program for us. Tell us how we can support you and how we can get in touch with you.
Just first of all, thank you. Thank you again. You have great questions. I was so afraid nobody would show up and nobody would want to talk or ask me questions. But I appreciate every, I appreciate all of you, and some, many of you I've met before. And I want to shout out to Evelyn and to Maureen and Sandy and to Brian. And I think there were a couple others who I've lost track of, but they are very helpful to me also. And I just want to let them say that publicly. But definitely recallfincham.com. LD11Democrats.org, very easy to get onto. Drop us a line, sign up for messages, help us keep track. And also, if you have a moment, you can write down my phone number. Like I say, I give my phone number. Hold on, I'll put it in the chat. It's got to be to everybody. Hold on. Okay. My phone number is 520-240-0741, okay? And feel free to give me a call. And if you want to get something else through me, that's fine. But yeah, give me a call anytime. And thank you again so much.
All right. Thanks so much. I appreciate everybody coming as well. And we're out of time, and I'll look forward to seeing you at the next meeting of Democrats of Greater Tucson. Catalina Hall, thank you so much for being part of it. And I want to wish everybody a great day. See you in a week.